The title of the presentation is Cluster-Based Analytics to Promote Students' Learning Achievement, which is the title of a work that we have been done in collaboration with the University of Bolívar in Cartagena de Indias in Colombia. The main issue that we are going to address here is the problem of unifying the criteria for evaluating students and classify them in terms of the different concepts that in which they have misunderstandings. So the main idea is on one side to create a basis for a test that could be equal and balanced between all the items, and on the second, on the other hand, to create a way to provide a feedback and group and cluster the students in terms of misunderstandings of the subject matter that they are studying. And what we have as a real case is, or maybe the context that we are addressing here is an exam that they take there in Colombia at the end of the secondary school. We are talking about an exam that is made by all the student population there, is based on different tests, and it accredits the level of understanding of the different subjects of the secondary education. What is our role in this work? Our role is to identify the weaknesses of all these students, identify and diagnose in which different matters inside all the knowledge that they have to study, they have some flaws or different or weaknesses. In this sense, the idea is to categorize all the different subjects and structure them into a kind of a taxonomy that divides all the syllabus into different parts, and then identify with different levels of granularity which are these weaknesses inside the all this knowledge. As we know, all the main problem in many tests is to make it balanced and overall to make it to create a set of items that could be represented. So there's nothing left behind in terms of what are we scoring inside the subject, and also to provide a way to make all these tests independent enough in terms of that there are no, this is one of the properties of the test that we will mention later. They don't provide or they don't ask for two concepts in the same question. So they are independent in that sense. They don't provide this, the level of understanding for each question is provided only of one of the topics that we are covering. So talking about tests, we maybe know some of the background behind the creation of tests. One of the things is we try to provide, the idea is to identify all these misconceptions on test. But the main purpose is also to make it accuracy. So it's not only based on identifying this misunderstanding, but to make it accurate and reliable in terms of students. So the way we are going to do this work is to provide two elements in the scoring of the students. One of them is to use item response theory, which is a way to provide different properties or good properties on tests that avoid, as I have mentioned before, the independence of each one of the items that we are going to score. Is every question of the test is supposed to be related only with one item, and is supposed to be only related with one of the one of the topics that we are going to cover. The second thing that we are going to we are going to address is that we don't only need to have a score or a measure in terms of how good a student was in one of the tests, but also to classify them or group them or cluster them in terms of which are the elements that they don't know. So if we try to identify in what level some students have misunderstandings, we can maybe provide a better guidance only for those, only for that group. That would be the idea. So So what are the properties of this of this theory of this of the theory that guarantees the item response theory in the context? So the main properties is that we have in traditional tests we have a lack of invariance in the properties of the test, and using ITR, the main achievement that we can have is that we can make the test comparable. So we can measure from 1 year to the following one the level of understanding the different topics. So that makes the test, maybe in one of the sessions of the test we can measure between the students, but if we don't provide invariance, the problem that we have, you know, we cannot compare between the different assessments that we are performing. This is a well-known property of item response theory. And in the other side, we need to provide a score that could be homogeneous between all the people in the different tests along the time. So with those two properties, we choose the technical achievements of the item response theory to make the test that we are going to perform. This is obviously it has let's say a level of mathematical understanding, so we need to calibrate the test with different parameters. This is we are not going to go inside this complex thing that, but it's well known that we have different levels of parameters that we need to adjust in order to provide the accuracy. So we will not go through the mathematical or the mathematical levels, but we show there that there are different ITR models to provide the unidimensionality of the different items that we are assessing, and we need to give some values to these parameters in order to calibrate the whole test. But once this is done, what we provide is a diagnose methodology. So we guarantee that we are assessing all the items in our knowledge base, and we are providing way to evaluate the level of understanding of each one of the elements of the knowledge. So the second thing that we have to do in order to perform this test is to provide a taxonomy of the or categorization of the subject matter. In this sense, we can make a taxonomy or an educational ontology based on the different parts of the subject matter and group the items of the test related to the concepts explained in each one of the subject matters. So finally, what we get using the test and dividing the subject matter the way I'm showing in those different concepts is that we provide a level of understanding of each one of the concepts or grouped in the different items of the test. So you have the table there, where you have on top of the table the concepts and as columns, and in the rows you have the different items of the test. The values provided here are the scores that we are performing, or the scores that the student has in each one of the different subjects in the test. We may, or we have built a little application that can perform the other part of the analysis, which is once we have the explanation of the results of the test, we want to know about group by, I mean, when we summarize all the items in the test, we need to know which is the level of understanding of the of a single student in each one of the different topics that we have prepared. Considering that we have a threshold of understanding, which is in this case a certain measure, which is 0.6 in our calculus or in our calibration for the theory. So everything under that level of understanding is supposed to be a weakness, or is supposed to be not understood by the student. Everything over that is assimilated, or we can consider that it's okay. So we have marked here in red, I don't see the color in the slide, but everything marked in red is supposed to be under that threshold, which means that it's a weakness, or it needs more studying or more drilling and practicing to be assimilated. In the picture, we show the result for one student, which is below the picture, the number that is at the end of the caption phrase. What does this mean? This means that maybe we have thousands of students and we perform this analysis for each one of them. So what we have at the end of the analysis that we made with using data mining techniques is a list of the different students and the different levels of understanding of the of all the different parts of topics here. So what we are going to have later is that the student, which is this student, for each one of them, we have a path in the tree that shows us that here we have a problem, and from here to here we have some matters that are contained in the different nodes of the trees that are related to a misunderstanding. So in our little in our application, what we have here, we it's very small to see, but the that there is related with the node and the subject, different elements of the subject matter that we in which we have the, distributed or structured the content. So we have learning paths associated with each one of the weaknesses. And did give us a clue for a single student, which is located here, of what are the different paths that he or she should be taking in order to improve. Okay, once we do that, then we go to the part of the clustering, which would be a way to group the students in terms of subject matter weaknesses. For all the students, we perform that calculus, and we have the learning path that shows us what are the problems, where are the problems, and how they are grouped. Clustering is also a technique of data mining, so there's nothing new. We use Euclidean distance to calculate in the vector of the students' performance which are the ones that are closest to each other. So in that sense, what we are going to do is to group the students with similar weaknesses and generate what is known as a dendrogram, which is the tree representing the different elements of the subject matter and what are the students that are grouped under that classification. Here we have the groups generated in terms of in a non-visual representation. So we have the list of students with these weaknesses, and finally, once the cluster is done, we can show the diagram of the different topics of the subject matter and what are the students that present problems in the understanding of the subject matter. So with this, we have the second part of the student diagnosis. The first of all, on the one hand, we identify what are the problems, where are the problems in terms of subject matter, and on the other side, we identify who are having these problems and provide them a proper feedback, because the idea is for each one of these groups of the students, they can be redirected to a specified courses or specific retraining program that can make them reinforce the misunderstandings or the flaws that they have in the subject matter. So the idea after this is to provide a feedback to the student, or to provide maybe a more training specifically focused on the things that they still don't know. So the idea is that we have performed an example of assessment involving item response theory and also involving data mining techniques. On one hand, we provide tests that are very, at least calibrated and uniform in terms of independence between the items. And on the other hand, we provide a way to group the students using easy techniques, because using R and performing this analysis is not complex. It's not a complex task, so it would be easy after this work to provide this software diagnosis, which is the following thing that we have in mind with this. So another thing to mention maybe is interesting here is that the work is a real case. So we have performed this evaluation on real students in Colombia with this exam, and it would be interesting to see, or we are now working on evaluating the second part, which is actually providing the feedback or doing the tool to provide them with the appropriate set of items that could reinforce or make them learn better those misunderstandings, and then evaluate how accurate we are in the diagnosis, because the idea is, on one hand, to provide to see the picture of the state of the student, but the interesting part also is to see if we can improve or we can help in some way this student. So assessment maybe is not only related with just taking the picture of what they know, but to also give them the real clue or the interesting clue to really make a better understanding and make them learn better. And finally, these slides that I have presented are the result of our work that we presented in the EduCon conference in Berlin, 2013. So you can find the paper there. And I would like to thank you for listening, and I'm open to questions. Thank you very much.